Thanks for visiting the Refuge Church YouTube channel. We're glad you tuned in and we pray that you're blessed by the message. We join the service already in progress.
In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, last week we were talking about the tabernacle. And we were kind of, you know, breaking it down where we saw that everything that was inside that tabernacle points to Jesus. And I don't think I've said how much I like Hebrews. You know, I can't say it enough. We go through and we read it, and if we do that superficial thing where we just kind of skim across the top, what we end up doing is viewing it in such a way that's kind of, that's nice, that's not really for me, I'm not Jewish, or I'm not. But when you really start getting in and understanding what Paul's saying, I believe Paul wrote it, what we start seeing is what he's really communicating to these people. You know, they were Jewish, yes. They were saved, absolutely. But the things that he's explaining are things that we can pick up on, absolutely. And we got to that chapter 9, and it started talking about the tabernacle, describing to them that there's a better, right, in heaven, quite literally. And he is the high priest now at the real in heaven. And we were kind of describing that. When we did, there was a point where I was describing to you that there were, not really hidden, but there's messages for the seekers, you know? It's that we're workers that need not to be ashamed when we study, when we dig, when we seek. And when we find that, God says, I've left things in there, little hidden treasures, little things that are inside there. One of the things that I brought up was a message that was placed in the genealogy from Noah to, or from Adam to Noah, okay? This is the genealogy. The when you see the way that this is placed, you know, you read it, and again we go, oh, brother, how many times you read something and it goes, and then he begat him, and then he begat him, and then he begat him, and then you go, okay, is it time for lunch? But it's when you're a seeker, you know, the ask, the seek, the knock, and it's going to be open to you. And you look at that, and you go, okay, that's the genealogy that goes from Adam to Noah. Okay, now read what those names actually mean. The God-man is appointed a mortal man of sorrow is born. There's a comma there, sorry. The God-man is appointed. A mortal man of sorrow is born. The glory of God shall come down, instructing that his death shall bring those in despair comfort and rest. Those are the names of the genealogy from there. Now, there's another part to it. It's kind of a hidden one. I'm just going to throw a couple nuggets out to you here. The next one's an acrostic of the same, but this one goes from Adam down to Abraham. And just the acrostic says, I will forgive my enemy, showing compassion. And it says, forgiving those made from dust a second time. That's an acrostic. So we've got it in a genealogy. We've got it in an acrostic. And now there's another one I'm not going to do, but it goes from Adam to Jesus. And it's more than just a single thought. It's an entire message. So if you guys are interested in that one, the one that goes from Abraham or Adam to Noah, or the one that goes to Jesus, let Roy know after the service, and he'll just click print, and we'll pull a couple however you need. I was going to print them, but you know, we just waste printer ink. So if you are interested, just go, hey, Roy, give me one of those, and he'll print them, and we'll pull them off there for you. But the point that I'm making with those is that our God, the creator of the universe, is many times placed in a box. And this morning, it seems like the tone or the theme of what God's doing today is get out of the box. Get out of the box, take off the restraints, let's go forward. You know, this is where we're moving forward. Matter of fact, somebody was just sharing with me right before the service that it appears as though 2016 is even kind of being, all right, people, get the boots on, let's go forward. It's time to move. It's time to get things going. And this is the spirit that's there. So as we dig and as we seek and as we knock, God's going to show us things like this. And at some point you can look at it and go, oh, neat. But the stuff I'm going to show you today is going to go, oh, neat. Look what that just did for me. So as we go moving through this today, you're going to see how complex our God is. How intricate, how detailed. I mean, you thought a watch was intricate. You know, for those of you guys into computers and whatnot, you see a couple pages of code and you think, oh man, that's complicated. But you're going to see how complex our God is, yet at the same time, how simple and elegant He is. How much He can communicate that message to us in a way that even us humans, even I can get it. So when we see this, it doesn't really matter where you are in your walk. Some of us go, I'm just not that guy. I'm just not that girl. I'm just not that one that gets into all the details and all that kind of stuff. God's going to meet you wherever you're at. See, that's the thing about God. Like that prodigal son, when that father saw him, he ran to him. See, all this, you know, well, you got to go to seminary. You got to go to where? See, all this kind of stuff is trying to make you go to somewhere else. God's going to go, no, right where you're at. If you're willing, I'll meet you there. If you're not willing, he's going to let you do whatever you're going to do. Free will, right? But as soon as you go, God, I want to know, he's going to go, then I'm going to walk right here. I'm going to link up with you right here, and we're going to walk this out because you're willing, wherever it is. And he'll take you to stuff like this in your way, in your understanding. And you're going to have just epiphanies. It's going to pop. All of a sudden, you're just going to be astounded. And then when somebody says something like, well, I'm an atheist, God doesn't exist, you're just breathless. I can't believe you'd say something like that. It's so incredible that that's not true. So it's far beyond, I believe what my pastor says. It's far beyond, I believe what whatever denomination I used to be attached to says. This is something that is like, I believe, period. That's it. So last week, we were in that, chapter 9, we were talking about that tabernacle. Every aspect of it, right? Getting over to Jesus. And the tabernacle was with those Israelis for years. Remember? It went from the wilderness, went through all that journey, got packed up, loaded up, moved, and it ended up in Jerusalem. And at its permanent home in Jerusalem, it was retired. And it was replaced by a permanent temple in its place. Now, King David wanted to build it. King David, remember? God after man, man after God's own heart, right? So he wanted to build it. He wanted to be the one. He loved God. He danced his clothes off. This guy, he wrote Psalms. You read his Psalms, you can just hear his heart pouring out. But he couldn't, because he was a man that had bloody hands. And he couldn't do it. So he arranged the financing. He got everything arranged that was going to be required so that his son Solomon could build that temple. So this temple that Solomon built was there standing until King Nebuchadnezzar from Babylon, the Babylonian king. He had come in and swooped up the people from Israel. This is where we see Isaiah. This is where we see Ezekiel. This is where these guys get picked up and taken away. And it was that temple that was standing. And there was a rebellion of the people. Hey, we're not going to let this happen. And there was a prophet named Jeremiah that says, don't rebel. This is the judgment that's falling on us for what we've done. This is most definitely, and they didn't listen. No, we're going to fight. And they did it once. And he said, don't do it. They did it twice. He said, don't do it. And they did it the third time, and King Nebuchadnezzar had enough. And he went down, and he flattened that temple. He flattened everything there. He took the rest of them, and that was it. That was the end of the temple. When they come out of Babylon, only about 50,000 of them, King Cyrus had said, I'm going to give you money. I want you guys to go back home. As soon as Cyrus walks in the gates of Babylon, Isaiah had written a scroll. And that scroll that was written was presented to him. And his name's in it. And God said, I'm going to use Cyrus to set my people free. And Cyrus is astounded. You know, he's a pagan king taking over the Babylonian kingdom. So he says, I want you guys to go home, and I want you to go back and build that temple. And I want, okay, so, but only 50,000 of them had gone back. So they went back. There are stories in Nehemiah where they've got a sword in one hand and tools in the other trying to build the wall to keep the enemies out. And they're trying to get this done. Well, they get a temple built. And you can call it Nehemiah's temple, or you can call it Zerubbabel's temple. And it was so sad that the people that had been alive at the time and saw Solomon's, when they saw this one, they cried. They cried. They were so sad because it was such a, just a fraction of what the other one was. But they had that one for a time. Now we get to King Herod, King Herod the Great. He wants to get some brownie points with the Jews. So he does this big, giant remodel, you know, and he puts his big remodel on there. That's the temple that's around when Jesus is walking the earth. So those are the, you can call it two temples, one second being remodeled, or you can call it three. Most people call it three. So when we closed last week, I asked a question. We know about that temple. But the Bible says that we are the temple. So where's that temple after the cross? Where's the temple after the cross? We know that in 70 AD it gets flattened. A lot of conversation going on about it getting built again. But as far as the New Testament is concerned, after the cross, where's the temple? See, I asked that question, and you guys that study to show yourself approved, you all jumped on that and said, right there. Matter of fact, the Bible says seven times, you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. And when you think of it, how many times? You got that one right? I think Roy was asleep. So seven times. What's that number of completeness again?
Seven
times. So if you're taking notes and you want to go look them up, there they are. So inside that, we see that God's dwelling place with his people on earth went from a portable tent coming out of Egypt, and it went all the way to Jerusalem. Why was that? Because that's where his people were. And then it was in Jerusalem, a permanent building. Why was that? Because that's where his people were. Then it moved to the entire world. Inside anyone who believes and receives that gift, right? Anybody that believes and receives that gift. Why is that? Because that's where his people are. His people aren't bound up in churches. This is a building. This is walls and roof and carpet. You guys brought the Holy Spirit in when you walked in. He doesn't live in this building. He lives in you. So you are that temple. Okay? Now, this is all in agreement with what Jesus told us in John 14:15. It says, if you love me, keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever. How long?
Forever.
The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. Not next to you, not with you. You don't got to go visit him. You don't got to go down to the church once on Sunday to see what's going on with him. You don't got to send him an email. He lives with you. That means wherever you go, he goes. Whatever you're doing, he's doing. Ouch. Uh-oh. Now, a revelation or understanding that is really much of what the teaching that we base our teaching on here is that we are a spirit. We have a soul. And we live in a body. Now, that is how our creator, our architect, our contractor designed and built us to be the temple of God. Which temple? Which one? I mean, out of the three temples that stood in Jerusalem, which one was it? Solomon's was the only temple that was truly unique. It was the only one that was unique from the other one. In fact, Solomon's temple was unique three ways, three important ways. One, it was the only temple that every single detail and design about that temple was dictated by the Spirit of God. Every single thing about Solomon's temple came from God directly. 1 Chronicles 28:12 said that God gave him the plans for the entire thing. The second thing is that it was the only temple that God's Spirit dwelled in. What? Yeah. He moved in 1 Kings 8:1. Lots of stuff going on. Big thing coming out of that tabernacle and going in. And that Shekinah glory that came in, when it settled down inside that Holy of Holies, It filled. It was smoke, and it just empowered that whole place. The priests had to come running out of that place. They couldn't breathe because it pulled out, and that was when it moved in, and it was awesome. And you read everything about that in 1 Kings, and it was just incredible how God moved in, and it was like, God's here now. But thing we don't talk about too much is that Holy Spirit moved out of that place. During the time that they were rebelling, during the time that Israel was walking away, during the time that these priests were doing stuff that they shouldn't have been doing, before that king came back to flatten that thing, the Holy Spirit left. Matter of fact, Ezekiel 11:23 talks about how it literally came out of the building, it went up to the top, and then it just moved on and went up to the top of a mountain, and it left. It never came back to the other ones. That was the only temple that it was in. The last thing is that it was the only temple where the Ark of the Covenant dwelt. That was the entire thing. That was it. That tabernacle that they went throughout that wilderness with, that was the reason. That was it. That's where the sacrifice blood was put. So it went into Solomon's, but it never went into the other one. When they went in and sacked that place, they've got like an inventory of the stuff that was taken. Do you remember the handwriting on the wall? Remember that? Why was he being called on the carpet? Because he was having a party. And what did he do? He said, run over there and get all that Jewish stuff and bring it over here. And let's drink and use all the stuff from their temple. Let's party with it over here. That's when that hand came up. There was no ark. There was no ark. Not long before that, God had called Pharaoh Necho to up there. He was in a battle doing something, really on God's plan, and he took that ark, and that's when it went down to Egypt, which we were talking about last week. So, you look at Solomon's temple, it was beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. But keep in mind that the temple was not supposed to be the Crystal Cathedral. It wasn't supposed to be something everybody just went, oh, look how beautiful. That same temple was exactly the same purpose that the tent was. It was the exact same purpose. It was worshiping God. It was having that ark inside there. God lived inside there. And it was supposed to do that continuously, right? So now, let's look at that floor plan of that tabernacle from last week, okay? You remember the general outline. The Ark of the Covenant is inside the Holy of Holies. The menorah, Jesus said, I am the light. The table of showbread, right? Jesus is the bread. The table of the incense, that was the prayers of the saints, right? So we saw all this. We went over all that last week. Okay, now, the Solomon's temple has got the same basic floor plan as the tabernacle, but it's got a few different additions. Now remember, God gave every single part of the design to the builders. Okay, so there were some different additions here. Now I'm going to show you something. Jesus was asked, which one of the commandments is the greatest? Right? Somebody trying to be a smart aleck. And Matthew 22:37, Jesus said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and with all your mind. See, what Jesus is quoting there is something very Jewish. It's called the Shema. And it was something that came out of Deuteronomy. Well, if you go back to Deuteronomy 6, and you look at that and see what the actual quote is, you see something kind of unique. It says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your... Mind's not there. Jesus added mind. So, the difference here is something that Jesus added. So when we look at this, it's not a typo. I went and checked. It's because the position of the New Testament believer versus the Old Testament believers. You, today, post-cross, have the ability to renew your mind. You have been given something from God that the Old Testament didn't have. See, this is not an error, Jesus quote. He's saying, we're moving on to something more now. We're moving on to something more. So now, remember the tabernacle, right? The original one that we were talking about last week. Okay, this is what we got. Now, the same layout with some additions to it, just like Jesus adding mind, look at this one here. Okay, that one is the temple. Now, you can see how born-again spirits were the living temples here of the Holy Spirit. So we're going to look at this one right here, and we're going to see some things. Now, let me bring myself up here. Ezekiel 36, 26 says, "A new heart also I will give to you, a new spirit I will put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my statutes and do them." See, as God made us born again spirits, this right here is what got changed. Remember, we are the temple, right? Remember, inside there, the Holy of Holies? See what He gave us? He gave us a new spirit. He gave us a new heart. This is what He's saying here in Ezekiel. As a born again person, God moved in. He moved in by bringing His Spirit. He moved in by bringing His life. He moved in by giving us a new heart that has His thoughts. Everything about God is moving into us there. So when we see this new life, that is in the holy place. Remember, that was the Holy of Holies? That's where God dwells. Where does God dwell? He dwells in the Holy of Holies. So inside us, He dwells in our Holy of Holies. And remember, just outside that was the holy place. Not the Holy of Holies, but the holy place. Well, inside that holy place, in us, that's where the heart goes. That's where we got a new heart. That's where we got everything that is new. Everything that God comes in, everything that says, "Man, I'm different. I feel different." It's because of that. Do you remember also when I was talking about this? What was all the stuff inside there made out of?
Gold.
Gold. Why is that? Because gold speaks of purity. Speaks of righteousness, speaks of holiness. That's why everything inside there's gold. That's the part that got replaced inside us, okay? But we still got conflict going on because we still have an old mind or old thinking to go along with God's Spirit and God's new heart, right? So there's something else that gets added here. See that right there? God gives us a willpower. See? You still have willpower to choose, but He gives us a willpower to say, "Okay, I'm going to discern some things. I'm going to see some things as they come in to me." Matthew 22:37, Jesus said, "Thou shalt love the Lord God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind." That's the mind. Everything that we're dealing with out here, what was it made out of? Brass. Made out of bronze. Bronze was something that was to be judged. It was something that needed to be, the reason they used it was because it could withstand fire. So that's why the bronze was out here, because it still needs to be judged. This is the mind. This is the stuff that needs to get renewed. Isn't that what Romans 12:3 says? The renewing of the mind. This is what he's talking about. Okay? So when you see this, it kind of explains some things. Jesus said in Luke 11:34, "The light of the body is the eye. Therefore, when thine eye is single, thy whole body also is full of light. But when thy eye is evil, the body is also full of darkness." The eye in that verse right there is speaking of the mind. It's our thought process. It's what we're allowing to drop into our heart. The porch is where we allow things to enter into our heart. How do you get into that first place where our heart is right there? There's only one door. So how do I get in there? Through that porch, through that mind. We're allowing it. If your mind is clear, then everything going into that heart will be clear. But if your heart is dark, or if your mind or your eye is dark, everything that's going in, the whole thing is going to be dark. See how God aligned this with this porch right here? Now our Father, wanting us to grow in understanding, He gave us more than just that willpower. See, our loving Father wants us to get it. He doesn't put obstacles that are insurmountable. He doesn't put up things and go, "Oh yeah, if you can jump over that, you know, I'll show you something." He makes them very obtainable. So what He gave us, He adds one more thing here. What He puts is there's these two pillars out there. Those two pillars right there, they held up absolutely nothing. Nothing. They sat out in the front. They were tall. They were huge, too. And they were bronze. These two things out here have very specific names. See, the right one is called Yachin. And the left one is called Boaz. Remember the names, how they meant something? Well, Yachin means his counsel. And Boaz means in his strength. See, so what he has given us is for the thoughts that come in, we got to process them. We got to be able to say, is this good or bad for me? Should I get involved in this or not? How do I deal with this? We deal with it by the gifts that he's given us in this new temple that we've got. We're able to deal with it by processing things through his counsel. We're able to deal with it through his strength. So when thoughts come into you, you can't just say, oh, I didn't have any control over that. You know dang well the Holy Spirit was right there with you going, mm-mm, out. Or the thing came in and said, jump on that and hang on to it. Because it's his counsel and his strength that everything must pass through to get there. See, it's incredible to be able to think that all of the casting down of thoughts and imaginations, how would you know which to cast down? We were talking about this in men's Bible study. How many times does a thought come that says, well, I could go to Bible study, or I could go visit some people in the hospital? Well, you could easily go, oh, well, I'm doing God's will and going over here when God said, I need you in that Bible study. You can go there on a night you're not having a Bible study. So how do you process these things? They're not always cut and dried like that. How do you process them? Through his strength, through his counsel, through his wisdom to be able to grasp this. Now, God could have made Solomon's temple any way he wanted, and he did. God could have made us any way he wanted. And he did. We talked about the male and female design. And we thought, okay, it kind of makes sense. The male and the female are obviously designed the way they are so that we can procreate, we can, you know, have more and keep going. But why couldn't God have done it a different way? He could have easily. Why that one? As we start reading it, we realize, wow, that's even another type. Where, why are we the bride? Why is he the husband? Why are we, see all the connections that come in, you go, we're designed this way because in our very design, he's saying, I want to show you something. I want to take you to a place where you get me way beyond just a, oh, I heard it from my pastor. I want you to get this so much that you say, our very design points to God. And it's the same thing that he's showing us here. When he designed it, he could have did it any way he want. What he's saying is, you're the temple of God. Okay, got it. And he's saying, this is you. This is the design that brings us into the knowledge that we are one with him. This tabernacle, this temple design. Everything pointed to Jesus in the tabernacle, didn't it? Where are all those things? Inside. Where is Jesus living today? Inside us. See how this design just keeps duplicating itself and showing that we are one with him. This is the design that makes us possible to be overcomers. See, this is design that focuses more on what we are saved to instead of what we are saved from. We don't need to walk around being sin conscious. We don't need to walk around constantly thinking about what I did and oh my gosh, and I'm dragging this baggage and what a terrible... That gets cut off and we move forward. We're always focused on what we're saved to. That oneness, understanding where we are, understanding that I grew from that and I'm going to this. That whole purpose right here, which kind of brings you to this, even though we're this temple, there's still conflict, isn't there? There's still the conflict of sin that we've got to deal with every single day. Doesn't make any difference if it's at the grocery store, driving down the road, with road rage. We still have this conflict that we deal with because we are saved people, new creations, living inside this world. So this conflict that's going to keep continuing on, the enemy wants to use that and control that porch. The enemy wants to get a hold of that gateway in. If he can control that, then all of a sudden he's going to be able to dictate what's going to get dropped into your heart. He wants to be able to do that. We've got free will to be able to say which one is going to control what's happening here. To choose and to receive who we are, our identity, understanding that we're sons, and then don't just stop there. Oh, what a great revelation. This is what I was talking about. We can understand this today, but when we walk out, you need to be able to go, I'm going to walk different. You need to be able to take what's being said and understand this whole thing, because it wasn't just a pat on the back for God to go, aren't I cool? It was something to go, I designed you this way for a purpose, and when you can grasp this and understand this, I want you to take this now and live different. I want you to take this understanding, and when you go out into the world, you're going to have victory over what's going on, because now you understand how I designed you. Okay? When confronted out there on that porch, I mean, and I kind of like the way that this is described, because it almost sounds like a bare-knuckle brawl, don't it? Satan comes over there and knocks on your door and says, hey, I'm bringing something here, and you say, I'm going to meet you on the porch. I mean, that's what it sounds like. We're gonna have some words here. So they go out there on that porch, and when this occurs, one of three things is going to happen. You're going to openly follow God. Nope. Out. You're going to openly follow him. All right. Right? I mean, that's pretty clear. But there's a third way. Third way we might act. Hypocrisy. We're going to act like we're following God on one hand, but on the other hand, we're going to go ahead and do it. See, that hypocrisy puts something where Satan ends up with tools in his toolbox he's going to beat you over the head with. Now, let me show you something. It's interesting because these priests right here had the same problem. Remember how I said that this is the way it was designed in Solomon's temple, and God said, I'd had enough. That's when it came down. Well, here's the deal. These priests in here had, when this was designed, there's a set of lockers that goes around the outside. Now, those lockers that are right there were supposed to be there so that the priest, they had cycles. Think of it as shifts. We have shifts at work. They had cycles. So they would go and do the things that needed to be done. They would do the things that were ministering inside there. Well, there were tools necessary for that job. Well, that was supposed to be basically their work lockers, kind of. They would put the tools inside there, and that's what they would do. But here's what started happening. These priests were worshiping pagan gods. They were taking in the gods from these pagan groups that were around them, and the idols and the things that they would have, they'd hide them inside there. And you didn't think God knew that? At one point in time, you even read in Ezekiel where, whether it was in the spirit or whether it was physical, he actually saw them worshiping these things inside those lockers, which was connected to the temple of God. And it was blasphemy. It was incredible. They would come out here and do all of their priestly duties, and then they would go back over here in this locker, and they had these pagan gods. Well, that's kind of what we do when we're being a hypocrite. See, that's kind of when we're doing the godly thing out here, but inside our heart, we kind of, okay, well, I'm going to go do something else. Well, that's what those lockers were. See, now, when you see this stuff lined up with this, and that third choice starts to come down, and we do that, this is when we take stuff that we don't deal with here, and where does it get stuffed? It gets stuffed down inside. You can call this subconscious, however you want to break it down. It's stuff that we haven't dealt with that just gets crammed in there. And what happens a year from now? Satan brings it up. It starts coming back up again. This is where we get the world saying, oh, you've got all these problems because you had daddy issues. See, that's their explanation for everything. I mean, the truth be told, they'd go analyze Eve and say, well, Eve did what she did because she had daddy issues. Well, you know, all these people, oh, they had issues because, well, it's because we keep stuffing this thing down here instead of dealing with it. I can't tell you how many times that I've heard counselors, some labeled Christian, and they say, well, let's dig that up and let's talk about that. No, the only part of digging that up that needs to be done is where we dig that up and we go, out! Out! We don't need that stuff hanging around. I don't need to analyze it. I don't need to remember it. I don't need to talk about it. God doesn't. What does he do with it? He puts it as far as the east is from the west. He puts it in the sea of his forgetfulness. Done. And then what does he talk to you about? Your future. We don't talk about the past. We're going to talk about the future. We're not going to talk about who you were. We're going to talk about who you are today and what you're going to be, because I love you and we're going this way. But this is what they did. And they stored that stuff in there. And they thought that it was the stuff that nobody would know about. See? Except for the person that built the temple, God. Kind of the same thing we do. These are the things that are going to be burned up. 1 Corinthians 3:10 says that whatever you build with wood, hay, stubble, straw, where's it going? It's going through the fire. What else do you build with? Well, gold, silver, and precious stones. Where's it going? Through the fire. And whatever comes out the other side, this is the reward. Well, when we send that wood, hay, and stubble through that fire of Corinthians, what happens to it? Poof. Well, this is what's going to happen with the stuff that we keep stuffing down there. This is not godly. Now, isn't it interesting that those things right there, they're made of wood, those lockers. And it's no coincidence that the actual Hebrew word for that is something to be burned up. All of that right out of that temple right there. Okay? So, just as God made Solomon's temple, and he gave those priests instruction on dealing with these conflicts, on dealing with sin, he did the same thing with us. See, he said, just as God said, you are my temple. You're where I'm living. God says, this is how I want you to deal with sin in your life. I've told them how to deal with sin, and just like that's a pattern of us, the way that they dealt with sin is a pattern of what we're supposed to be doing today. See, the open sin in our life that just occurs on a daily basis has to be dealt with. Just like the hidden stuff that we've got crammed away that we think nobody knows, it's got to be dealt with. See, the enemy wants us to be so sin conscious that it doesn't ever even come to our thinking what it would be like for us to walk as a son. We're so concerned about the weights that are around us and what a terrible, oh, I'm this and I'm that and I'm horrible, that we don't even consider what it would be like to live as a son. We might think of it in the sweet by and by, oh, one of these days after the rapture, whatever, but we don't ever think about what it'd be like to be a son set free here, because the enemy knows what the effects of a son walking free looks like.
Yes.
And he wants that kind of a life restricted. And he restricts it by wrapping us up with thoughts about, oh, don't, yeah, I know you heard about being a son, and I know you heard about walking free, but that's not for you. See, that's where the word came out this morning. Lift your hands up, receive this, because it is the restrictions that you've been putting on yourself that God's got for you. We are restricting ourselves from, God's not restricting us. When we start going, when I hear that word about a son, that is for me. And you start to tell the enemy, we're going to take this out on the porch. And according to his wisdom, according to his strength, I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Those words about the Son, they are for me. And all of this transpires out there on that porch. God wants us to walk free in victory so that he is visible to all of creation. I'm telling you, the word is happening right now. We were even in prayer this morning that we work on us. That is what you can control. You cannot control anybody. Not your wife, not your kids, not your husband. You cannot control. You can control you. So do it. Work this stuff out. Because as you do that, and God puts you in a group such as this group right here of sons, then it starts to click together, and that oneness grows from you to the rest. And then that means that when this oneness right here breaks up at the end of a service on Sunday, then that means we go back to our lives. But we don't turn off the Christian switch. We leave that switch on, and we go back, and we live that life that we're here. We live it there. And what does it do? It shines light in the darkness of those people that are around us. That's what God wants us to do. That's why this mechanism right here was done, was so that we can deal with stuff on a daily basis. Without this, we got this whole, yeah, I really need to get right with God. Or we get, man, I'm doing really good. And then the balance between these two is just how you feel. See, it's all emotions. How many people did not feel like coming to church this morning because cloudy days are really good days to sleep in? It's okay. It's okay. See, we can be led by emotions, which now we're letting the enemy's strength. The enemy starts to set into us. There was a verse that I don't think I wrote down, but it was in John, and he's talking about how Jesus was saying of Satan, the only thing Satan can bring you is darkness and deception and lies, because that is his resources. So that is the two pillars that Satan would try to put up here. In Satan's wisdom, which is ignorance, which is lies and deception. So we can either be led by those emotions, or we can be led by the Spirit of God. And those who are led by the Spirit of God, those are called the sons of God. So we can be led by the Spirit of God, which means emotions follow us. The emotion of joy and peace and happiness that comes out of us is not because we're pushing it out, it's because it's following us because of who we are. As opposed to something from the world, we're projecting, oh, I don't like this and I don't like that, and I'm going to fake it today that I'm happy. Well, that's the enemy leading us around, kind of like a horse with a bit in his mouth. You can lead him wherever you want, as opposed to the other way around. I'm a son. So what follows sons? Peace and joy. What did we say? Everything I put my hands to is blessed. Why is that? Because I'm a son, not because I'm saying that. It's because I'm a son. It's because of who I am. It's because of my identity in Christ. This is what follows me. So when you walk into a room that is negative and satanic and dark and all that, and you walk in, don't go, uh-oh, and flip off the switch real quick to blend. Leave that switch on. And you walk into a place, you don't got to go beat them over the head. Just live. Just live. And when you live, you're shining light in corners of darkness. God was showing us that the word is going out and people are getting their lives changed in places we could never imagine. There are foxholes being dug by ISIS where there are people that say they're following Islam and they're following Allah, and the word is getting in. We can look at that and categorize it all we want, but in the big picture, God died for the world. Right? 1 John 2:2, that he died for everyone in the world, including them. And when we sit back and realize and go, I'm a son. I'm not an American. I'm not a certain race. I'm not a... Because Paul said that in Christ, there is no divisions. This is the oneness. And when I realize and I start walking around going, I'm a son, that means everything that he is... He's the light of the world. What are you? The light of the world. Everything he is, you are one with. So carry it out and walk it out and move it out and keep going. Because he's designed this for us to do just that. All right? So when we see this, we can see that there is a living temple. Okay? And this living temple, now you can see who we are. What did we say in the beginning? I am a spirit, I have a soul, and I live in a body. Look what he designed. We are a spirit, brand new. We have a soul. And that outer box right there, that was the outer court that they put together. That outer court, everything that is set up right there, where was that whole temple complex? It was where the people were, where they lived. Where do we go? Where people live. So this is who we are. We are a spirit. We have a soul and we live in a body, so the sin that we have to deal with on a regular basis, the same thing applied that we talked about the tabernacle. As soon as somebody, we allow somebody, right? It's a choice. As soon as we allow to interact with somebody, what is it that they should be interacting with? What's the first thing we said last week? That sacrifice. It was Jesus. That was the first thing that people should run into. So the way that this is set up is a perfect example of us today. So when we're talking about dealing with sin in us today, begin with knowing your identity. You are in Christ. You are a new creation. You are currently one with Jesus, and that will not end. That is for eternity. Understand that. Know that. Then let your permanent outlook, not just the outlook you have while you're in church, let your permanent outlook, while you're out there in the world, while you're talking to the relatives that you don't like talking to, while you're talking to the people at work you don't like talking to, while you're getting gas, driving a car, all the things that you do, let that permanent outlook be from that perspective. I am one with Christ. Think from that perspective. Speak from that perspective. How many times do you let things just ramble out? Think from there. Speak from there. Act from that perspective. Absolutely. Act from that perspective. And then, when that conflict of sin comes up onto your porch, now we can follow exactly the pattern that was given to those priests. First off, acknowledge it to God. When we sin, we sinned. Right? Let's not pretend. We sinned. So what do? Yes, I sinned. I'm going to own it. This is when those priests would walk in and they would walk over to that laver. What was the laver made out of? The mirrors. So what were those priests doing when they were washing their hands? What were they staring at? So when you go over there and you own this, you go, I'm owning it. I did it. You're absolutely right. You're washing in that laver and you're saying, yeah, that's it. I'm owning this. So you remember that Jesus already died for that sin. Is there any sin that you've committed that Jesus has not died for? No. I mean, think about this for a second. How many of your sins that Jesus has washed away already, how many of them were in the future when Jesus died on the cross? Unless somebody here is 2,000 years old, all of them were in the future. So what about the ones that are going to happen tomorrow? Died for. Next week? Died for. Next month? Died for. Done. Finished. So, but the enemy wants to come over and go, you're a dirtbag. He does. He does. When you make a mistake, when you say something cross to somebody, when something occurs and you immediately, and he starts beating you over the head with it, oh man, God ain't going to like that. Okay, hold on. God didn't know I was going to do that? Let me tell you something. God knew exactly what he was getting into when he paid for you. He is not trying to find the receipt to return you. And Satan has come over to me and said, I tell you what right now, God would return you if he could. And I'm like, man, I feel terrible, God. And you start putting yourself back in that spot. No. Every sin that has occurred has already been paid for. So when you remember that Jesus already died for that, you go to the cross and you crucify your old self. This is what Paul said when he goes, I die daily. This is what Jesus was talking about. Pick up your cross. You think they didn't know what the cross meant? It meant death, a torturous death, as a matter of fact. And if we're supposed to pick up that cross, if we're supposed to die daily, what we're saying is, my old self, some more of him is going to die now. And you put him on that cross. And what you're saying is, I don't want to be a part of that sin. This is the problem that we run into when we say, oh, well, would you allow those kind of people in your church? And there's a big old list of things that they try to throw at you to be politically correct. And we go, are you kidding? That's why we're here. We're the solution. This is where God... But at the same time, the question is, are you struggling with sin? Are you trying to tell me that God says it's okay? This is where you're making that a line in the sand. I do not want to be a part of that sin. I am turning away from that sin. I am dead to that sin. My life is in Jesus. And I am walking forward. So that sin, Father, I see it exactly how you see it. Wrong, incorrect, and washed by the word. And you kill it, and you walk off, and that's it. We're going forward with this. Now, what do you do? That was the sacrifice. Now, what do you do? They were told to move over to that molten sea. That thing was huge. It was a big jacuzzi. I don't think it was heated. So you got this big jacuzzi now, right? So what they do is we climb into that molten sea and we wash. What are we washing with? We're washing with the word. So what are we doing? We're filling in those gaps that Satan is going to jump on there and go, that didn't do nothing. God still hates you. Because that's what the enemy is going to do. Because you go walking over there and you had errors. You had a sin. Something occurred. And when that happened, you say, God, I'm turning this over to you. And Satan goes, I didn't do nothing. You're still carrying it. And he still wants to, you drop it, he tries to hook it back on you. You throw it down, he tries to hook it back on you. You get over there into that molten sea, and you go, enough. And you wash, and you wash in the Word, and you wash in that identity, and you wash and know who you are in Christ. And that's what you do to finish that off. You're replacing the lies and the feelings, the emotions. Let's get rid of that emotion, and let's go, no, I'm with God's Word. And you're the one that's going to know, am I playing games? Are you really done with that sin? Or are you going to leave it around? Like, I'm sorry I'm doing that, but I still got it on a leash. Or did you really let it go? These are the things you've got to wash in the Word to go, I really need to let this go. But once you've let it go, you're on rock solid ground. I'm done. I'm done. God, walk with me with this. And you continue on now in that oneness, in that fellowship. No condemnation. None. None. You just walk off and you say, I am one with Him. You are clean by the blood of Jesus. Now continue on without being sin conscious. Walk in the knowledge that you are dead to sin and alive in Christ. You are one with Him and an heir to all that He is. This is who you are. So now we can see that we're being a spirit and a soul living in a body. It lines up with that temple, right? Our Creator, our Architect knew what He was doing when He created us with free will. I know a lot of us would go, Lord, I would really much rather that you just take it because I don't seem to drive this car very good. I do. But He knew what He was doing when He created us with free will because He clearly designed us with the ability to make godly choices with this free will. That's what those pillars are. He said, no, I gave you free will because I gave you my Spirit to be able to use that free will accurately. When we are one with Him, when we know who we are, when the revelation that we are sons becomes a reality in your everyday life. When it becomes a reality, when you're waking up and getting dressed for work, when you're driving down the road and you got to get to work, when you're at work, when you're doing things, all of that, when you have this revelation of who you are, this is when it starts coming into effect. Not just today. Hear me. I'm telling you that there is an awakening happening today. This is, concerning this specifically, and it's increasing. I'm telling you that Nathan and I and his mom had a conversation 2 years ago. We were finishing each other's sentences, talking about oneness, talking about sons. We had a third guy, Christian. You guys have met him from Romania. He was bringing the same thing. We had no connection other than God. And we thought, isn't this great? Josh knew a guy that he was teaching about identity, and he was in somewhere in the South, Oklahoma or something. So we're hearing this, and we thought, oh, isn't this great? But I'm telling you that this kind of thing is happening more and more. We're hearing people starting to click, starting to go, wait a minute, who I am makes a difference. See, the important part of this is who God is, and connected to that is who we are in Him. And when we start grasping this and understanding it, our lives are changing. There are believers that God is giving God-inspired epiphanies about what it means to be a son. The faithless, powerless religious activities of the past, they're dropping off. They're disappearing. I just read an article from Reuters that was saying that the highest foreclosure rate by financial institutions on churches is already in effect because that they can't pay whatever these things are. And the pictures that they're showing are these big, giant, huge things that are going on. That's because they're trying to equate cars parked in the parking lot with souls in heaven. There is no equate to that. We're talking about identity. We're talking about ownership. We're talking about responsibility. We're talking about saying, yes, I'm going to walk this out. And then when we do, you start seeing those people that are walking that out, suddenly they're walking in victory. Suddenly they're coming up and they're going, do you know I'm seeing something right now in my life that I never noticed before? You know, like that used to bother me. This used to be an issue. And I realized who I am. And I said, that's not going to happen. And it dissolved. It knew that I was a son. This is what we're talking about. There's a scripture that talks about when the enemy comes in, he raises up a standard against him. Who do you think that standard is? Us. We are that standard. Well, he raises up the Holy Spirit. Where's the Holy Spirit? in you. In you. So the enemy has been speeding up the cadence of the world. Would you guys agree with that? Things are like this. You got a schedule. You better hurry up. You better get it done. I got to get it done. We got to hurry up. Are we there? We're late. Oh my gosh, I got to get this done. What are we doing? Are we done yet? Hold on. What's on? I got to get DVR stuff to record it because I got to get back to it. I mean, everything is just speeding up. The reason for that is because when everything is sped up like that, the enemy then can operate chaos in your life. That spirit has free rein to walk around up on that porch. Because you're allowing things to just move and faster and hurry. And when something comes along, you don't stop and say, I need to pray about this. Because it's faster, faster, faster. The sons that are getting this understanding of who they are, they change and they go, I'm not going to operate on the world's time anymore. I'm not going to operate in the world's cadence anymore. I'm going to operate on Father's time. And I'm telling you that one of the words that came out was that some of the signs and wonders that we're going to see in 16 is like time dilation, time adjustment. Well, that's crazy. That's nutty. Happened to Joshua. He said, Lord, give me 24 hours. I need to whoop these people. I need 24 more hours. And what did he do? He gave him 24 hours. When we're walking in this, the Father that we serve, the God that we serve, he's the God of everything. Why not time? Why not your finances? Why not relationships? Why not attitudes? Why not emotions? He's God of everything. The only restriction that is there is that you don't let him. Let him move in this area. Let him move in all this stuff. So the temple that we, tabernacle, Jesus, temple, us, with Jesus in us, this is how we're going to walk this out. This is how we're going to move. This whole thing that we were talking about, it's to understand who you are and understand that God set this thing up. What I need you to do is to walk this out, God said. Yes, you're going to have sin in your life. You are. You're going to have sin in it. But when you do, what are you going to deal with it? And he goes, I just need you to be, what's the first thing that you put on in the armor? The belt of truth. I just need you to be straight with me. When you're not straight with me, a stronghold starts getting built up. So when you sin, you bring it to God. And you put it right up there on top of that altar, that sacrificial altar. And you put it up there and you say, Jesus already took care of this. Now I'm going to crucify myself also. And then what do? Get back in the Word. And you live this out. Well, man, I'd have to do that 1,000 times a day. That's all? Really? I don't care if it takes 2,000. I'm going to go lock myself in the bathroom so I don't got to deal with it. You're going to have to do it in there too. This doesn't escape us because what are we dealing with? Thoughts. So know who you are, church. Know who you are. Know how you're walking. Know the God you serve and know that you are one with him. So that when this stuff comes up and the enemy knocks on your door, you take him out on a porch. And when you take him out there, you clue him in on who you are. In God's strength. In God's wisdom. And you put him away where he belongs. And then you keep operating. And then doing that for yourself, shine that for others. Shine that for other people. Tell them, this ain't about religion. This ain't about church. This ain't about being plastic and phony. This is about being real, and I know you're hurting, and I know God loves you. And by living this and making this something real, you're going to be able to be a light to them. Amen? All right.
We hope that God spoke to you through this message. Our goal at Refuge Church is to assist in the growth of believers within the body of Christ. To leave a comment about this YouTube channel or for more information about Refuge Church, please visit our website at www.refuge-church.net. If you're in the Inland Empire area of Southern California, make plans to stop by and worship and study with us. We're located at 24711 Redlands Boulevard, Suite K in Loma Linda, California, 92354. Our men's Bible study is on Wednesday night. Our women's Bible study is on Thursday nights. Our Sunday morning service begins at 10 a.m. and it's also video broadcast live on the web, as well as our audio podcast. You can access these via our website, Thanks again for listening to Refuge Church.